नमस्कार, मायसेल्फ प्रोफेसर रमेश गौर, यूनियन हेड कलानी डिवीजन, इंदिरा गांधी नेशनल सेंटर फॉर द आर्ट्स, एक्सटेंड ए वेरी हार्टी वेलकम टू यू ऑल इन टुडेज वेबिनार ऑन रिट्रोग्राफिक साइंस एंड टेक्नोलॉजी फॉर प्रिजर्वेशन ऑफ एंड एक्सेस टू डॉक्यूमेंट्री हेरिटेज. We have a very eminent panel, and we have as a chief guest our member secretary, Dr. Sachidanand Joshi, to inaugurate the webinar. The panel, which consists of a person from industry, a person from who has wide experience working in National Archive, and also currently working in Delhi State Archive. We have a person representing a microfilm collection in an important library. And beside, we have our own colleague, Dr. Deepraj Gupta, who is the authority on microfilming and other reprographic tools and technologies. So with this panel, we are going to start this webinar. To begin with, I extend a very hearty welcome to our member secretary, with whose blessings and guidance we have been organizing all these programs. He's a force behind all our activities, a well-known academician, a great administrator. He is a very good writer and having a versatile personality in the field of journalism, in art and culture, and in the field of Hindi literature too. To begin with, I also welcome our speakers for today. We have with us Mr. Sanjay Garg, who is currently head of office, Delhi State Archive, and prior to that, he has served in various positions, including National Archives. We have with us Mr. B.M. Hari, who is a technical director. There is a company, Cracks India, so he is a person from industry. We have Dr. Ajit Kumar, a library information officer, a Nehru Memorial and Museum Library. We have with us Dr. T.R. Gupta, a senior photography officer in Kalanidhi Division of IGNC. And to present vote of thanks, we have our research officer, Dr. Jaspreet Singh. So with this eminent panel, this discussion I'm going to chair, I just want to begin with certain important points regarding this use of reprographic technologies, and particularly why it is so important to think of preservation. And here, when we are talking about various tools and technologies, we are talking about preservation of documentary heritage, and preservation in the context of long term, not in terms of short term preservation. We are talking how we can preserve our heritage for the posterity. So this is something very, very important. Resources in our libraries and archives. So let me just give you some glimpses of the world we are living. With this rise of machines, we are in Google age, and e-governance has become reality. It is more so real in today's world because of this pandemic situation. We all are working from home, and this mobile revolution has really given us an opportunity to reach out to people wherever they are. Besides, combination of mobile technology with social networking is a blessing in disguise. And that way we are surviving in today's world. When we talk about documentary heritage, if we think the various kind of stories, how documentary heritage was stories, if we start from clay tablet to current hard disk and storage, optical storage media, or floppy drive, or now we'll talk about whatever hard disk drive. See, this is a big journey, and in this, although technology stories is increasing, but if you talk about the life expectancy has reduced a lot. If you talk about clay tablet, the life expectancy was up to 10,000 years. And when we talk about a CD drive or a hard disk, that is very uncertain. Even 5 years is not a definite time to say that this hard disk will survive for 5 years, or this storage will survive for five years. So this is a challenge, that how to preserve our documentary heritage. Although technology has integrated our world in a very global place, and recently our Prime Minister has very rightly called about vocal for local to global. So we are in a global place, global world, where countries and culture are much closer than ever, and including history of mankind is very easy to retrieve and find out. So when we talk about preservation is not alone. Preservation is always linked with access. Without access, preservation has no meaning. So whenever we want to preserve something, we want to preserve with the objective that it is going to be used in distant future. And we need to understand here, when we are talking about preservation, we are not here talking about conservation. These technologies, what we are talking in right context, we are not talking about conservation. We are talking about preservation, long-term preservation, or digital preservation. We are not referring here conservation, because that is a curative kind of treatment to rectify it or improve the life or extend the life of the objects. So why preservation is important? To link the past with future. And knowledge is one thing which lasts. Media may be changed, but knowledge remains same. Significant part of the world, knowledge is heritage in digital form. So we need to preserve this memory of the world, both in print, non-print, or electronic. So this digital preservation has become a very, very important concept, very, very important criteria to preserve the resources. At the same time, this digital preservation also has many challenges. When you talk about various challenges of digital preservation, there are a number of things which we have been forced to adopt it. It may be technological obsolescences. It may be loss of data. Like, to give you an example, location of NASA's original moon landing recording is currently not traceable, because the digital data they stored has damaged or lost. So when we talk about various advantages of digital preservation, definitely for access, digital preservation is the most important component, most important solution. Digital preservation for access is excellent. And when we talk about what are the other alternatives in terms of digital contents, let's have a digital preservation. But at the same time, we should also have an alternative. Like when I talk about NASA's this moon location, which is not retrievable, then after that, there was some kind of decision that they adopted the dual technology, and they are also adopting this hybrid technology of microfilming. And now microfilming is why it is so useful in terms of long-term preservation, because we need to preserve our historical record for long-term in a usable condition. And one thing is sure, that technology may change, whatever it may be, but we can easily scan the microfilms, and microfilm always save the time also. Apart from that, it is cost effective. Another most important example of microfilm is that when we talk about the authenticity of a document, when you live in digital world, it is very easy to alter the image or change the original contents. anyone can hack the sites and can change the content. So for posterity to understand the originality of the document, it is a challenge that how to maintain the originality of the document. If suppose today's manuscript in paper got damaged, and tomorrow if we have to justify, is this original copy of that manuscript or not? Microfilm is still a better option. Microfilm is the better. You can store an image in an original location. Now with color microfilming availability, this has become more authentic, more microfilm are easy to duplicate, portable, easy to scan, easy to reuse. But that also you need to put in a very proper storage, and care and handling is very important. Copying a microfilm is not that you copy it and everything is preserved. It is not the case. So you have to, like when I joined JNU, I found that thousands of microfiche and microfilm were lying on ninth story in a very, very humid and hot condition. And many of those celluloid films were melted. It doesn't mean that you copy the microfilm and it is safe. No, even microfilm need to be preserved in a very proper storage, and you have to handle in a very careful manner. So there are a number of issues concerning these technologies, and definitely legal aspects are also important. So in case of microfilm, there are less problem in terms of multimedia rights or technology and law. Copyright and other things, what applicable to a book is also applicable to microfilm. So that is easier. So what I want to tell you in the beginning of this, my introduction, that definitely digital preservation has to be done. But at the same time, microfilm is also a better media for a long-term preservation. It is not necessary to microfilm each and everything. You have to decide in terms of longevity and the importance of the documentary heritage, what you need to preserve in both microfilm and digital format. So we have to live in a hybrid world in coming years. So I think these were the introductory remarks, and I want to once welcome all the speaker, and particularly our member secretary, Dr. Sachidanand Joshi ji, for his kind presence and agreeing to inaugurate this today's important webinar on retrographic science and technologies. I request our member secretary to formally inaugurate and deliver the inaugural address. Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you, Professor Gaur, for organizing this webinar. This is an important topic, and we all must be realizing the importance of this, especially in the present situation of pandemic. We have with us a distinguished panel, Shri Sanjay Garg, Shri V. M. Hari, Shri Ajit Kumar, and our own Shri D. R. Gupta. All are experts in their field, and they would throw light on the important aspect related to reprography science, technology, its preservation, and access to the public at large. When we talk about the heritage related to the documents, it is an important aspect. And we must admit that we have not been very careful about preserving our own textual heritage so far. Although when we talk of the treasure which is available in India, as far as manuscripts are concerned, we must be the country which has the maximum number of manuscripts in the entire world. But unfortunately, the awareness related to manuscript and awareness related to preservation of manuscript was not very high, and in fact, people were very careless, negligent as far as the manuscript preservation is concerned. Similar is the case related to the documents and the books and the textual material which is available in our country. For us, it is very important to realize that if we are having some kind of a pride and privilege and on our textual tradition and rich cultural heritage, we must also understand that unless we preserve it, unless we properly document it, and unless our own scholars do some kind of a deep study in this and disseminate it to the other countries, there is no point in just saying that we have a rich cultural heritage. We have to work hard. Even in the pre-independence era, most of the time it were Europeans and especially French and German scholars who really did maximum research on our textual tradition. And they, in fact, sometimes brought some important facts related to our own tradition and culture to the knowledge of our own people. So this awareness has to be brought in. I am very happy to see more than 650 participants joining this important webinar, which shows that people have started getting taking interest in this field, and the technique and the technology and the methodology which is to be learned and which is to be derived is being now understood by the scholars by and large. It is not only the matter of people belonging to the library and information sciences or documentation sciences to really know about this entire process, but it is for the benefit of the scholar community by and large to know and understand about the preservation and retrieval of the information. Sometimes we only take care of preservation. I see most of the people belonging to different government institutions on this panel, and they would agree that our focus is on preservation of the things, but we often forget and neglect the dissemination part of it. In fact, the delivery system at the government institutions has been very poor. I also belong to a government institution, and I would admit that there has been lack of understanding and lack of zeal as far as delivery part is concerned. So it may be our archives, it may be our libraries, it may be our documentation centers. We always stress on the figures of documents collected and digitized and preserved, but we often neglected the data related to dissemination of that. How many people are really benefited? How many people are really taking advantage of it? How many scholars are visiting our site? That is also very important. And how our platform is a user-friendly platform, that is also a thing which is to be seen. Because when we talk about the digital era, sometimes only the information which pertains to a limited introductory sort of information that is available. But if somebody wants to go into the deeper sense of that knowledge, the scholar or the person struggles to really get through the and get the access of that knowledge. And our entire system is so complicated that sometimes the scholars really get dejected and do not really come back to us. That has to be seen, and it is the job of the professionals, especially sitting at the higher level, and I am happy to see quite a number of high senior professionals here to really devise a mechanism which simplifies the delivery mechanism for the benefit of the scholar. Because the dissemination part, if we overlook dissemination part, there is no point in just piling up and documenting the information which is not being used by the scholars. That system has to be really looked into, and for that we must also see the kind of platforms which we are providing, which we are making them available. They may be digital platform, but are they really being categorized or equipped in the manner so that it becomes an easier process for the scholar? Another thing is that what is our backup mechanism? Because we often struggle with the technology. We are not very techno savvy people. We must admit that we really are not very techno savvy people. Sometimes we lag in that kind of knowledge as far as backup is concerned, as far as systems protection is concerned. Sometimes our people are not trained. Even if they are not trained, they are not getting updated very, very regularly. In fact, the technology is not being updated very regularly, and even the systems are not getting overhauled. So those things have also, they should also be taken into consideration that what is our backup mechanism, like Professor Gaur has rightly said that the microfilming, there was a time when people thought that microfilming is the latest technology, and then people started putting up all those equipments related to microfilming. Soon after that, as soon as the digital technology entered, people started neglecting the microfilming system, and then everybody focused on the digital technology, and so much of advancement took place in digital technology, and microfilming almost went on the back seat, it went into the godowns, in fact, in some of the institutions. But at one point of time, then people realized that, of course, there is a much simplified manner in which things are preserved in digital technology. We need to have microfilming also, just to have the backup, because digital technology can anytime give you some kind of a hiccups, and that we have faced during recent past. So just to avoid those hiccups, people started looking for again the microfilming technology, and now there is a hybrid system which is in operation. I saw a couple of equipments which also provide you some kind of an easy methodology to do the microfilming and then retrieval of the microfilming. Those things have to be taken into consideration as far as the advancement of the technology is concerned. Another important thing which Professor Gaur wanted to point out, and I think he would definitely be throwing more light on that, that is related to the equipments which can be conceived in Indian condition. We are often relying on the technology which has been imported from different countries, maybe Germany. Most of the publishing and printing equipments, they come from Germany, or sometimes from France and China and Taiwan also. But can there be some kind of a model which can be evolved in our own country? And we have a very bright generation of technologies people, and I think that the reprography people and the technology people should sit together, and then they must evolve this kind of a technology which is India based, which is produced in India, which is thought in India, and which is conducive for Indian conditions. Sometimes it happens that we take the equipment which is devised in some European country, and when it comes to India, it does not perform the way it should have been performed. We have seen in case of some scanning equipments also. We have seen in case of some other reprographic equipment. Sometimes they fail to perform the way they should perform because we have different climatic conditions. We have different operational conditions. So those conditions have to be looked into. And number two is, if we are purchasing the costly equipments from other countries, we are paying heavy price of that. So on a low cost basis, what kind of equipments which we can derive, which we can think of, which are easily affordable for small institutions and small libraries and small documentation centers even, because transportation, taking entire bunch of material to big cities for getting scanned or getting digitized or getting microfilmed, everything becomes a little bit cumbersome. So can we devise some kind of a system, some kind of equipment which provide the technology at the lowest level, at the grassroots level? Those things, of course, will take us to the arena of Atmanirbhar Bharat, which our Honorable Prime Minister is saying upon. It's not Atmanirbhar is not just throwing foreign goods away, or it's not Atmanirbhar that just discarding everything which is made outside India. Atmanirbhar Bharat is to make things in our own country which are conducive for our own conditions. That is very important. So that thought process should be generated among the scholars. And I am very happy that we are having a very, very panel of very eminent persons who can think on these lines. And next time maybe we can also invite a few persons, few eminent experts from the field of manufacturing who have the capability of manufacturing. I don't remember, sometime few days back somebody showed me an interesting machine and they said that this is a book scanner which is devised, because what they did, they used a DSLR camera for scanning purpose, and made an equipment which was costing just 2.5 lakh rupees. And out of that, of course, the camera was costing the maximum. But an equipment which is easy to handle, which is easy to take along, and which is easy to get established anywhere, costing just 2.5 lakh rupees, is an affordable thing which can be afforded by any small library for scanning the books, which is affordable, rather than purchasing a scanner of say 2.5 crores and just putting it at one place and blocking it there so that everybody goes there and does the scan. You can have these kind of equipments evolved here, and we have the potential, we have the people around in and around our country who can do this. So that thing has to be looked into. Another aspect which I would like to emphasize on is the advancement in the microfilming technology. There are new advancement in the microfilming technology which have never been discussed in the recent past in our country, because once we thought that it is not in use, we have started neglecting that. Microfilm has to be looked into in a more serious manner, and the latest advancement, latest technological developments should be incorporated in the system. We have big libraries, archives. We have people from Nehru Memorial Library or Delhi Archives who are doing fantastic job as far as the preservation of documents and digitization of document is concerned. But at the same time, I would request you to also train bright young students who can take up this as a career's opportunity in future. Because if you don't have second line and third line of people who are dedicated and devoted to this field, I think this profession would not grow the way it should have been grown in the recent past. So the training part is also very important. Indira Gandhi National Center for the Arts has recently started doing some kind of a training and preparing manpower for this field, trying to meet up the future requirements in the field. But IGNCA cannot do anything. I think Nehru Memorial or archives or other institutions who are also capable of training people should also open up their arena for training bright young people. The more younger generation we have in this field, we have the bright future of this entire field. I welcome all the participants, and I also welcome our esteemed panelists who are here. And I'm sure that this webinar is going to be a very, very successful seminar, and this will pave a new way for building up a very dedicated, devoted, and skillful manpower in the field of preservation and reprographic techniques and technology. I must congratulate Professor Gaur for putting up a very good webinar for the benefit of the scholars, and my colleague Dr. D.R. Gupta, who is our reprography in charge. They would also be sharing their experiences related to the work which is being carried out by the Indira Gandhi National Center for the Arts, which is one of the biggest repositories, not only in India, but in the entire South Asian region. I'm happy to have Sanjay Gargji, who is an eminent expert scholar, we know, and V.M. Hari Sahab also, and Ajit Kumar is my friend. He is from the Nehru Memorial Library. So we have a good panel, and I wish every success with this webinar. Thank you very much. Namaskar.
Thank you, sir, for such a wonderful and enlightening, thought-provoking inaugural address. I'm sure you have given a lot of points to discuss and to give views by these experts. And you have rightly pointed out that this is a forgotten technology. I will tell you, like, so many webinars are happening in this during this period, and I'm 100% sure this is the only webinar happening on this technology organized by the IGNCA. I don't think any other institution even think of or thought of having this kind of discussion and webinar. And you have very rightly said that I think we have to understand the importance of cultural heritage, and this is a technology for long-term preservation in many aspects. And your suggestion of having on self-reliance and some kind of technological development within the country. Yeah, there are some examples, but not the way it should have been happening. It is also because of the, like, there are not many takers. There are not many organizations who wants to microfilm their collection. I think there's some kind of unawareness also, they don't understand the importance of this particular media, because technology, internet has so influenced the minds of the people, particularly Google. Like, people don't want to think other than internet or World Wide Web. So they don't see that there is something better option and better technology to preserve our, and particularly in countries like Australia or in US or in many European countries. Like, there is a full-fledged program of microfilming of their entire heritage. And even like when I was in Frankfurt in Germany, there in all newspapers of that countries are being microfilmed by the National Library of Germany. So there's this, they know that this is the technology they can rely on. This is not like making copies and keeping you in different location, even can take care of disasters and various kind of pandemic and other situations. So thank you, sir. It's wonderful to listen to you. And I'm sure with these discussion and about the education, another thing, we have been discussing and working. Vibraj has already prepared a blueprint to start a course on this reprographic science and technology, either as a short certificate course or we'll be put you to you either under this introductory program or certificate course program on this reprographic science and technology. So thank you very much, sir. And now we will start our panel discussion. And I think the first speaker in the lineup is my colleague, Dr. D.R. Gupta, a very hardworking and sincere person, and having a lot of innovative ideas. And we want to know today, like, what he's going to tell us in terms of various options and technology. So he has also worked in National Archive, and he's a very senior person in IGNC, and having a very good microfilm unit in our IGNC. If you want to visit, you can visit it. He'll use a person to guide you on that more. So over to you, Deepraj. Please start your presentation.
Thank you. So first of all, I would like to tell you what objectives are while presenting my presentation. There are certain questions which I have just tried to drive and to find out what are the solutions to that. This presentation may be a little bit eye-opener to some of the persons who are already in the field, and or to those persons who knows this archival science and all. First question is, digitization a form of reprography science and technology? And the second is, should it be referred to as digital reprography? Then, should the contemporary art of reproduction like cut, copy, paste, share, forward not be considered as reprographic technique? Should COM be considered as long-term preservation of intellectual properties of document heritage? And then lastly, I would like to tell you the initiatives what the agency has taken up to preserve rare and valuable manuscript resources. First of all, we have to understand what are the archival material. If I go to the definition, these are the information or objects that serves as evidence of past events. Or these are used to re-experience those events or to re-communicate information about them. But for a common person, I believe that the archival material are only those material which needs to be preserved for a longer duration. Means the material which needs to be preserved for a longer duration, that means we need to find out a technology for which through which we can preserve this cultural heritage. Now, if I go to the categories of the archival material, there are different kind of categories like original media, print media, non-print media. Original media like manuscript records, artifacts, print media, brief text media, paper base. Similarly, there are some non-print media like microform, audio-visual media, magnetic media, optical media, digital media. Digital media right today may not be archival material, but sometimes it may be archival material for future to be preserved, because we are just keeping digital material in digital form and some solid state drives or pen drives or external drives or server storage something. So that also need to be preserved. Now we have to understand the properties of the archival material. There are two kind of properties. One is intellectual property and second is physical property. Intellectual properties are basically the contents or its meaning. that is being contained in the particular text or the material in which some text is written. And physical properties are basically the artifacts, its construction, material, or design. So we have to see what exactly we are going to preserve. Are we going to preserve intellectual property or to the physical property? If we said we are going to preserve intellectual property, that means we find out a different solution to preserve them. If we are saying we are going to preserve physical property, there are different methods to preserve these materials. Now, there are certainly there are some threats. If there is no threat, I don't suppose there is any need to preserve anything. So we have to understand what are the threats and which decays our material. Like light, it has got ultraviolet rays, so it decays the documents and other archival material. Heat, humidity is very, very dangerous, not only for the archival material, but for the everything. So humidity is a very dangerous thing. We have to avoid this humidity and all. Then gases, evaporations, air pollution, particulate matter, fungi insects. You might be seeing on the right hand side, there are different list of the termites, I mean insects, termites, silverfish, cockroaches, book lice, etc. So these are basically insect and fungi, which enter into our archival material and just decay everything. And the people itself are also threat, because handling is very, very essential. If you don't handle the material properly, it will definitely decay. And definitely disaster, you don't have any control to the disaster, but you can have planning how to control that. So there are some certain threats. So we have to take care of these threats, how to save them from. Now we have to see what is reprography. Reprography, if I say in a common term, repro means reproduction and graphy means a science. Means reprography is a science which is used for copying and reproducing document and graphic material. It was first introduced, I mean the term was first introduced in 1963. The basic purpose of this reprography was to reproduce the document in facsimile exact copy of the document by any process like light, heat, electronic radiation, photocopies, microcopies, blueprint, electrocopies, thermocopies, and by any mean, reproduction by any mean, any method of duplication, whatever way, whatever method we got during the past, whatever we have got, if we have duplicated the thing, it has to be referred to as a reprography. Then digitization is definitely has to be referred to as an extended version of reprography technique in the new era of IT, ICT technologies. It applies to both hard copies as well as to the soft copy. I'll just let you know in the further slides that even the cut copies here, this is also a reproduction kind of thing. There are two terms, reprography and microphotography. So we have to understand what's the difference between these two. Some of the people, even I have discussed with some of the persons in the industry. So there is different means argument regarding that. But it's very clear. If you talk in terms of microphotography, it's a technique. If you talk in terms of reprography, it's a science. So science will exist forever. Technology may keep on changing. But reprography is basically a science. Science can never change. So basically, there are differences between these two terms. Now, normally we keep listening this word reprography is vanishing and there is no use now. Everybody has stopped working on that. So I would like to tell you certain things regarding that. You might have seen the computer science. Computer science is a science, but there are different inventions and development in that, like network, internet, ICT, then it was called IECT, then information technology, then artificial intelligence, then machine learning. So different developments and inventions in that computer science. So the original science remained intact. There is no change in that. Similarly, in the reprography, reprography is a science. Microfilm technology may be supplanted by digital one, or digital by may be supplanted by some another, because we don't know in future what technology is coming forward to safeguard our archival material and all. So we cannot say. Means the reprography term can never end. It will continue forever until we are using duplication of archival material for preservation purposes. Now, there are four kind of reprographic methods for preserving archival material. First is the photographic method, that is light sensitive, and second is thermographic method, that is heat sensitive, and third is electrostatic method, charge sensitive, and then last is digitization, that is binary conversion. So I would like to tell you a certain surprising factor regarding photography. I have just mentioned photography versus photography. What does it mean is? Means the camera which we were using earlier, that was the analog camera, and that we were using only films. But now there is a digital camera, here we are using image sensor. But the term photography remains same. There is no change in that. Because what happened, the person, the professionals who kept on using the analog camera continued to use a digital camera. So there was no change in that. And the same person continued the same term to be used for the purpose. And even a small child knows about the photography. He doesn't know about the old camera. He knows about the only digital camera, but still he used to say this is photography. But if I say regarding this microfilming or digitization, there is a term difference. I mean, here what has happened, the microfilm overhead camera has also been replaced by the overhead digital camera. The same thing has happened, but the term has changed. Now we have referred it to as digitization. We are not calling it microfilming. But the same thing has happened in the case of photography. If it was photography, then why it is not microfilming in case of digitization? What has happened? Only the camera head has changed. Nothing has been. The book credit is there. Document placement is there. Everything is there. Light sources is there. But the thing is, but the IT professionals who just developed or invented this technology, they don't use this word reprography, because either they must be not be aware about this reprography technique because it was older term. They have just drawn a new word, digitization, and they started using that. And the people who are in the archival science or the reprography field are very less in number, who may not have protected this particular word. Now, see, if you see the all the methods I have just tried to put in a diagrammatic view, there are two part of this. One is photographic process, and second is the non-photographic process. These were in photographic process, you may see on the left-hand side, there is camera process, there is some non-camera process. These processes were in existence. Let me have pen. So all these processes we were using earlier. These are also some of the processes we were using earlier. As the technology keeps on changing, we kept on changing the technique also. Then some non-photographic process just also came into picture. Then Daijo process, electrophotography, thermography, Xerox photocopying, like. Now, digital photography has also been started, and digitization. Digital photography means directly capturing the images through some DSLR camera, digital camera, and digitized means the proper CCD scanning and all. There are some other multi-pin methods also. Hectography, stencil duplication, offset duplication, planographic printing, letter press, laser jet, screen printing, plotter. And here you may see digital soft copy. Digital soft copy means cut, copy, paste, and share and forward. So this is one of the multi-copying method. We are just sharing many of the material on the mobile, on social media network, just copying it and sharing it to other person. So is it not the replication of the same material? Now, if I see in the other slide, almost all the methods have just gone away. So now there are two terms which we keep on talking about. The first is microfilming and second is digitization. Okay, now we have to find out what is the best way to preserve these materials, I mean archival materials. So people get confused. Some people say digital is better than film. The other person say no, it's not. The other person say film is better than digital. Somebody say no, you are wrong. So there may be two types of the statement. We have to believe on technology and media. So based on the technology media, we have to decide what exactly we are going to preserve and what technology should be used for preserving them. There are certain facts which I would like to tell you, like life expectancy of microfilm storage media. This is almost 500, everybody knows about it. This is, you might see on the Wikipedia. So the life expectancy of this material is 500 years. And if we see the digital media life expectancy, you can see here, disk is up to 10 years. Nano cartridges are 10 to 20 years, floppy disk 10 to 20 years, CD, DVD 5 to 10 years, Blu-ray disk, magnetic disk, hard disk, flash drive. So all these media has got a certain life, but these life cannot be referred to as long term. So means we are not finding a media which provides you a solution to preserve the material for a long term duration. So this is only the microfilm which provides a solution for 500 years preservation. There are certain advantages, if you just see to this, Long-term storage, 500 years, as I told you earlier, this is 100% secure technology, independent technology. It is not dependent upon any other technology. This is hard and visible, tangible heritage. If anytime you don't have any equipment to read them, simply a lens and a projector, light projector can be used to read the contents. Means the contents will never die. But in case of digital, the contents may die. If the driver to a particular media is not available, you cannot view the contents. Less space storage, less cost. I'll just let you know how I'm saying this 1/4 digital. I'll just let you know in the next slide. Free from technology migration, there is no migration required. Safe from hackers, viruses, migration and manipulation. File integrity obviously is there. That's why it is being accepted in court of law. And there are different standards that is recommended by international standards like ISO, NC, PSI, AS, and NS, etc. Now, is digital cost effective? That is a big question, but I say no, big no. Because it cannot be cost effective. Why? The life of the digital hardware is 3 to 5 years. You must be knowing that there is a depreciation to the IT equipment, computer equipment is 60%. So within 2-3 years, what happened? The cost of the equipment goes down. Even the technology gets changed 3 to 5 years. Even the hardware may work only up to 3 to 5 years. So that means you have to replace entire system of SAN, NAS, tape drives, etc. within a span of year of 4 to 5 years. And that may cost you crores of rupees. And even in the storage maintenance, you need high-end servers, and you have to keep the data at two ends, so only to maintain the backup system and all. So maintaining these high-end servers at two locations cost you very much. And then you have to keep one more backup in hard drives or tapes or Blu-ray disc or something like. So that also costs. And even this material also be to be kept in some places where safety measures are there. Then again, you need to get it refreshed, transfer, or migrate to the different media. If you don't get it transferred or migrate to the different media, because media get changed, so you need to get it migrated and transferred. Otherwise, what will happen? The driver of the media, if it is not available, you can read the contents even. What happens? Even the scanners, what you get in your way to digitize the material. That is also obsolescence, under obsolescence. They also, you need to get them also replaced after 3 to 5 years. They also don't work more than that. Then this digital system is still highly unreliable and sensitive. And still there is no guarantee to this. Now, there are technical obsolescences in digital technology. What are that? Softwares, hardware, and media. Everybody knows softwares gets updated. There are different softwares which were made in 2000, means Windows 7, then they may not be operative in Windows 10. There are certain software which are operative in Windows 10 that cannot be operative on Windows 2000, Windows 7. Similarly, the hardware. Hardware means media, we were using the floppy disk, CDs, and then different kind of other Blu-ray disk and all. If the particular hardware to that to read that particular media is not available, you cannot read that content. So hardware as well as the software keeps on changing. I'll tell you what happens. There are certain hardwares now. If you want to install to Windows 7 in the hardware, means whatever hardware is available right today, if you want to install Windows 7 in that, it's not done, because the hardware is not supporting to that. Similarly, the Windows 10, if you want to install to some earlier hardware, it is not supported. So means you have to keep on tracking the hardware, software, and media. So technical obsolescences are there. Based on the obsolescences, you have to find out a particular hardware and media and the software all together to seek the goal. There are certain more issues like technical scientific issues and challenges. Tracking change of storage media, I just told you earlier. So you have to keep on changing that. Then basic preventive measures that needs to be considered. Like Dr. Gaur told you, until unless we don't perform these basic preventive measures, nothing can be saved. Similarly, suitable storage handling, that is also required. Whether you are keeping the material in microfilms, whether you are keeping the material in digital form, so whatever way you are keeping, suitable storage handling is obviously required. and taking tracking changes in technology, that is also to be done there. Then you have to find out the solution of the technological changes. Selecting file format and its authenticity, there are different file formats of images. So you have to find out which is authenticity, which is more authentic and in public open source system. So if it is not in open source, then it may be a problem for us, because sometimes what happens, the vendors, the particular vendors who make the softwares or just give us the particular format to be read. So if the company is not there, you will not be able to read that. Similarly, the metadata from long-term access that needs to be kept in a proper way. You have to find out what exactly the metadata or means construction is there world over. So you have to adopt a single uniform system. And the future changes of obviously you have to consider. Now, there are three things: addressing, transfer, and migration. These three terms will keep on moving if you are just going to the digital means preservation system. Digital storage is always prone to hacking, virus, malware, malicious softwares and all. Easy human error like delete, replace, data crash due to many regions, maybe because of power fluctuations, shutdown, high voltage. Short life of media, I told you, media crash even. Migration of servers, storage, software tools and drivers. Non-accessibility after migration from one media to another media. This is what happens if you just transfer the data from one media to another media, you have to get it checked. If you don't check it, there may be a possibility of the error in that. You may not be able to access that particular data which has been migrated from one media to the other media. And then there are possible chances of cloud or web network exposure. So you have to seek solutions to that. If I talk in terms of digital data losses in India, because that is also a factor to be reviewed, to be seen properly, I just try to search it on Google. So you may be seeing that 26 crore 70 lakhs results are there. So you may be finding different type of the websites or the links, so which you would be able to know where the data crashes are there, how much data has been lost world over or in India. So I have just two slides to let you know digital data losses in India and digital data losses world over. Now, there are certain lists in which we can just see there are electronic data breaches. I'll just quickly move it to. Like, so there are different examples. There are means examples of data losses in different places, India and abroad. Now, there are new interfaces in the cryptographic technologies. One is the CAR and COM, that is related to computer. See, CAR is basically a computer-aided retrieval system. There are different types of softwares like Koha and all. We have to create a proper metadata and bibliographic database, and through which we can just find out the particular information what we are just trying to find. And COM is basically computer output microphone. We were just talking about the hybrid system. So this is the hybrid system which we may offer right today. Because computer output microphone is can be obtained from a digital form. So we can go for digital first and then to the microfilm after converting the digital images into microforms. Basically, the ultimate goal is what? That we need to find out. We are just going to preserve intellectual contents which have got the archival nature of that particular material. So we are going to preserve archival nature that has got the intellectual content. That means we have to find out a solution. That means we have to find out a solution which provide you long-term preservation. We are not going to preserve the material for a shorter duration. Archive means a long-term. So that's why we have to find out a proper solution to this particular thing. So ultimate, just seeking the ultimate goal, we have to say that you may see on the right-hand side, we can go from paper to digital and then from digital to microfilm. As I told you on the other side, the COM system. So we have to find out a combination of two processes, digital as well as microfilms. There are certain users in India, you may see a list. I have just put the IGNC at the top because we have got the largest collection. I'll just let you have a glance of the collection in some of my slides. And then there are some COM users world over, you may see on the right hand side. There are certain other technologies I would like to tell you. Some of the persons may be aware, some may not be aware. Wafer phase. We have seen the wafer phase technology. We have seen it physically. It basically a hardy substance developed using semiconductor manufacturing technologies. It was developed by NanoArc Corporation, USA. It's the surprising fact is it is said to be capable of withstanding humidity, water, and temperature over 5,000 Celsius. So it is said to be, but yet not recognized. So, but there is a technology. So I wanted that this should also be put into your knowledge. There is one more technology, digital microfilms. And what happens in that technology? It basically uses a high resolution photosensitive film as a digital storage medium. Data is written to the film as a large QR code, each containing 8.8 million pixels. This technology is also unrecognized and not even approved in India and abroad, but it's in the process. Even it can hold audio, video, and everything it can hold. Even a video and audio can be put into the microfilms. It is basically a microfilm, but it has been, means QR codes has been printed on that. Then management and planning. So this obviously is related to all the material. If you talk in terms of digital media, if you talk in terms of microfilm media, the physical media in itself. So these are basic factors which we need to take care. First is storage enclosures, second care in handling environment security in the system. A storage enclosure is very important. If you just put the material or throw it away here and there, so that may be prone to decay anytime. So you have to put it in a proper enclosed atmosphere. And even the environment of keeping the material should be a proper, at a particular temperature. And humidity, as I told you, it is a very dangerous thing. So we should avoid humidity. There is a particular parameters depending upon the media what we are just preserving into. So based on the media, we have to keep the material in a particular environment for proper safeguard. This particular material and for long term, and security measures obviously has to be taken care of, and above to that care and handling definitely we have to maintain it in a proper way, and disaster planning we have to do. Without this planning, what will happen? Everything will go in lost. So there are different types of planning. If I talk in terms of microfilm, so we need to prepare two copies of that. One is direct duplicating film and second is positive copy. Direct duplicating film is capped at other places other than the master negatives. And the positive copy is used for the scholar references. So in case of IGNC, what we have done is we have just kept one DD, direct duplicating film, at Bangalore office. So similarly, in case of digital media, we have to keep the material in different kind of servers at different locations. Now, let us have what IGNC has done. At IGNC, we have acquired almost 22,000 microfilm rolls or microfilms, which contains almost 7 lakhs of rare and valuable manuscript. If you count in pages, it may be more than 5 crore pages, mostly in Sanskrit language and on India art and culture. And this has been acquired from India and abroad even. This is a collection which has been acquired at National Manuscript Mission, IGNC. You may see it is almost 3.2 crore pages, 396,000 manuscripts we have acquired from different institutions. You may see it on the screen. At Kalanidhi repository, we also have got different types of the manuscript collection. You may see a list on the screen. So it also let us know what positive and DD we have created and how many rolls we have digitized. Like this. So if I just total it, so it is almost 21,941 rolls and 1,600 DVDs. So these are very rare collections which we have got in our possession. And there are certain microfiches we have acquired from abroad. You may see a list on the screen. This is microfilm acquired from abroad, almost 1,239. There are certain other collections that is in our repository. Now, you may see that there are service charges for a particular thing.
Right. You have 5 minutes to
just going to finish. So these are some bibliographic charges. If any scholar is requiring anything in microforms, so these charges are to be paid by him. If he needs a digital copy of the manuscript, then the charges are written over there. He has to put request to either to us or to the concerned repository from where we have got the manuscript from. So ultimately, we need, because under copyright permissions, we have obtained the material. So a scholar has to take permission from the original custodian. And as soon as we get the permission from the original custodian, we provide the material to them. Now, the concluding words I would like to say, it is based on the objective what I told you earlier. Ethnographic science is an archival science for preserving intellectual properties of documentary heritage, and therefore the term reprography will exist forever, irrespective of any technological changes. The digitization in the new age of digital technology must be considered as another form or technique of reprography science for preservation of archival material, and may be referred to as digital reprography. The contemporary art of reproduction, that is the facsimile or exact copy or duplicate by way of cut, copy, paste, share, and forward, has to be considered as a reprographic technique. Indeed, the real values of archival preservation technique has to be considered in actual sense. The conclusive concept of first digital, then microfilm com system may provide solution not only to preserve archival material, but also to provide easy access to our digital platform. That means the hybrid technology what we were talking about. And all the universities, this is very important, like to just bring it to notice of everyone. All the universities, institution, department involved in teaching reprography science independently or within the syllabus of library science need to pay attention to all the facts stated or referred into the presentation. And as such, there is a strong need to discuss the issues broadly and change the syllabus accordingly. Bringing the term digitization and contemporary art of reproduction, that is cut, copy, paste, and share forward, etc., as stated above, within the scope of reprography science and technology. So I think this is all from my side. So if there is any question or query, you can just write me a mail, because it may not be possible to give answer. If it is possible, we'll just answer your questions. But otherwise, this is my email. So if you have any question or query, and if there is any argument or comment, I will also welcome that. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Dipras, for such a detailed and very enlightening presentation. And I know I'm proud of you, such a hardworking, sincere and knowledgeable person in this field, and always try to do something innovative and very creative. And I'm sure people like you can contribute a lot in reviving this particular technology and convincing the people about the importance, because so far it has not been well taken, and it's a very challenging job, and I'm sure you can do it. And we'll take up question answer in the end, whatever questions come through web chat and Q&A. So now let's move to our next speaker, Mr. Sanjay Garg, who is currently head of office, Delhi State Archives. Recently, I have heard a lot of news about Delhi State Archives, digitization, and creating a lot of archival facilities and access facilities. So I'm very keen, and I was thinking of visiting you, but somehow my schedule didn't allow me. But now this is an opportunity to know from you. You are a man who has seen both the aspects of microfilming and digital technology. So I think I'm very excited to see your presentation, yeah. What you're going to tell us. So over to Sanjay, please. You can share your presentation.
Yeah, thank you. Phone कर दो मुझे। अरे पहले वो अभी नहीं करो यार उसको। सर अभी ऑन नहीं करा मैंने। Unmute करो ना। Are you hearing me?
Yes sir.
Hello.
Yes we can.
Good afternoon everyone. First of all, I convey my sincere regards to IGNCA to give me an opportunity to present my PPT on the prestigious project of the Delhi government. Under the project, you can say that 40 million pages of records will be digitized and microfilmed in a span of 30 months. As usual, being the government department, we also face a lot of challenges in implementation of this project. But with the support of the government and my staff, we overcome from all the such challenges, and project is on the way. Before giving my presentation, I will show you a small film on the project.
सरकार दिल्ली के इतिहास को सहेज के रखने के बहुत महत्वपूर्ण कदम उठाए। इतिहास सैकड़ों साल पुराना है और अगले हजारों साल तक इसकी जरूरत आने वाली पीढ़ियों को पड़ेगी। यहाँ की राजनीतिक गतिविधियां की डॉक्यूमेंट्स दिल्ली के इतिहास से संबंधित डॉक्यूमेंट्स बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट है और इसके 10 करोड़ पन्ने हमारे पास ऐसे रखे हुए थे, गल रहे थे, फट रहे थे। आपके साथ इन डॉक्यूमेंट्स को सहेज इनको लेटेस्ट टेक्नोलॉजी यूज करके इनको आने वाली पीढ़ियों के लिए संरक्षित रखा जाए।
Department is having the variety of archival heritage pertaining to the historic city of Delhi. We have records since 1803 to 1990, consist of several records such as trial of Bahadur Shah Zafar, Farman and Sanad of Shah Alam, Buckboard records, Central Jail Bihar records, gadgets of Punjab, Delhi, Government of India. Then we have the records of Deputy Commissioner Office, Commissioner Office, Chief Commissioner Office, rare manuscripts of 400-year-old on religion, Ayurveda, etc. The government has initiated an ambitious project to convert this archival heritage into digital so that the public can access that record with a click of the mouse. For the implementation of this ambitious project, the government has engaged NISG as a consultant of the project, and the tender of the project was launched in January 2017, and due process of the government has been adopted to select the agency after scrutiny of technical and financial bids, and the work has been awarded to Messrs. Nine Star Information Technology Limited for the implementation of this project.
Under the initiative of Delhi government for the digitization of archival records, the process involved in my section is cropping and then meta creation.
This digitization is being carried on high-end scanners, for example 600 DPI. These scanners are from Germany, and you can see a set of scanners where people are working, and this has got high productivity so that we can meet the scheduled outputs per day.
During the course of 30 months, you know, this company, Nine Star Software Company, they will convert all the records that are around 400 of the pages, you know, first in the digital format, and after that, this digital report will come to them. The digital format when you are converting things, and this nature company, they are also supplying a proper software for access of the reports from the used data. Once the recording is done in the format, it is a parliament report.
By deploying this high volume EB microfilm recorder with a daily capacity of 50,000 plus pages, Nine Star introduced for the first time in India the Panasonic Blu-ray data archiver, which enhances the digital data lifespan compared to old LTO tape technology.
These archive writers will pick up the digital images and convert them into the raw microfilm.
Now I move to the on the PPT. Basically, we were established in the 1972 with the sole aim to preserve the archival heritage of the historical city of the historical city of Delhi. Our vision is to preserve the archival heritage and make them available to the general public. We have variety of records like files, manuscripts, firmans and sanads, photographs and negatives, maps, plans, microfilm, microfiche, audio video tapes, etc. Then we have the variety of record series such as the record of resident of the Commissioner of Delhi Division, First War of Independence 1857, resident of the Commissioner Delhi Division, stray records from 1803 to 1912, Deputy Commissioner Office record 1857 to 1960, Chief Commissioner Office record. Then we have the Chief Commissioner confidential records, which can include the political activities of in Delhi from 1911 to 1947. Then we have the central jail records, means the convicted record from 1896 to 1990, sub-registrar office record from 1875 to 1993, CID records of Delhi Police from 1900 to 1970, government gadgets including Government of India, Punjab and Delhi gadgets from 1900 to 1970. Then we have the private collection of eminent personalities of Delhi, and recently we have acquired the private collection of Fakhruddin Ali Ahmed, late president. Then we have the manuscript from 17th to 19th century. These are the most important archival collection of the Delhi archives. For one of the most important one is the trial of the Bahadur Shah Zafar. That is the only copy available in India. Basically, the challenges of traditional archives is that at a time only one scholar can view a content. Search is organized only through the limited options, and for each type of content, separate device is required to play, view or move in the detailed cases. To overcome from these traditional challenges, we go for the digital technology, and first of all, we have engaged the consultant of the project, that is NISG, for requirement analysis, best practices, DPR, preparation of RFP, technical evaluation of the e-tender, drafting and signing of the implementing agency. Then we floored the e-tender of the project of 40 million pages. Then pre-bid meeting were called for the, then we on scrutiny of PQB, technical pilot project of 10,000 pages and financial bidding, the implementing agency has been finalized. That is the project overview. Here the collection is coming up, then the digitize. One images go for the website on or e-abhilekh portal. Then the final images will be go in the NIC data center in Blu-ray and one server located in the Delhi archives. And the other images go for the microfilming and then the microfilming storage. This is the challenges and implementation details. Basically, you can see that the condition of records are so brittle. We are facing that it cannot be even scanned. So before scanning, we need the conservation and other processes for to handle all these brittle records. Further, the records are in different formats, from less than A4 to A0 size. Next. This is the implementation strategy of the department project of digitization, receipt of records, then the check-in. I think you can go through all these slides so that you can get the idea that how the process is going on. Next. Now the final output of digital images we are getting in the 300 to 600 DPI depending upon the document, TIFF images, high resolution PDF and low resolution JPEG files, desk queue, crop, split. Delivery format is in the microfilm, Blu-ray archives, DMS, web-ready PDF. These are the machines we are using. One is the Bukai scanners. We have installed 8 Bukai scanners. Then we have 3 I2S scanners. Then one I2S super scanner for A0 size of maps. This is the scanning site where our digitization work is going on. Here the metadata work is going on. This is the e-abhilekh portal. from where you can access approximately 1.75 crore of pages with the registration. Actually, we have two type of record. One is the property records, then we have the archival search. If you go for that property records, we have two sort of search engine. One is the simple one, then the advanced search. If you just go through the anything, any clue you have, then like Indira Gandhi. You will see that a huge number of records are coming up in the name of Indira Gandhi. Lot of these are the trust deed, like IGNCA, then the property records, any GPA or anything, whatever you want, then you can find the records. And if you want to see the original one, you can see the records. Similarly, you can also search the archival records like Bahadur Shah Jaffar. Then you can find the records like that. So that is the search engine. Basically, I want to show the. Next. This is the Blu-ray optical disc archival, which we have obtained for the permanent preservation of the high resolution images. Then we have the data center at Bhubaneswara of NIC, and we are also utilizing the cloud services of NIC. These are the machines which we are using for the microfilming and microfiche. One is the Juscel OP 500 SMA 105, then we have the SMA 51. This is the process. I think Mr. Gaur and Mr. Gupta has already defined the technicality of microfilm, so I need not need to explain in this is the microfilming process lab. This is also the machines installed in the microfilm. This is our microfilmic storage. Presently, actually, we have awarded the work of 40 million pages. Currently, we have achieved the target of 3.40 crore. And out of that, 1.75 crore is on the portal for accessing of the by the general public. And out of which, 1 crore 40 lakhs has been microfilmed and microfished. This is the project cost. Actually, we are spending huge money for the implementation of this project. Then, Basically, object of the project is to access the records to the historian, public scholar, citizen and government department of NCT of Delhi, facilitate awareness among the youth and children about cultural heritage through web access to make Delhi archives the first digital archives, not only in India, but in the world, to facilitate the journal user, then to use the latest technology available around the globe for proper preservation of cultural heritage of the historic city of Delhi. Before concluding my PPT, I want to highlight the other important project of the department, such as Heritage Club in the government. We are establishing Heritage Club in the 60 school, government schools as a pilot project. And we are also coming up a brief history book for the middle and secondary level student on history of Delhi. Then we are also implementing the fellowship scheme, and we have engaged 13 fellows for the research and development of the archives. Then we are also implementing the oral history program, and 19 interviews has been completed in the year 2019 and 20, and 15 interviews we are planned in the 2021. And then the major oral history that the interviews are the Sahid Siddiqui, Miss Mohini Hingorani, Jawaharlal Khajanchi, Kashmiri migrant. Then we have the interview with the Prem Chand Sharma, Secretary of Yamuna Ghat Resident Association. Other important thing we have done is the conservation of physical records. In the last financial year, we have completed 5 lakh folios of records. Then we are also coming up with the coffee table book that is called Bapu the Unforgettable with the HT Media. And under the, our main emphasis is to highlight the footprints of Gandhiji in Delhi. Then we are have the archival awareness program. We are regularly organizing the exhibitions such as Virasat-e-Mehroli at Shamshi Talab Mehroli, Footprints of Gandhiji in Delhi, Delhi Secretariat and Central Park. Then we have done the Dastavejo mein Punjabi Virasat, Central Park, Heritage City, Delhi, in Delhi Heart, INA, Vikaspuri and Pitampura. We have recently also established the Bhagat Singh Archives and Resource Center for preserving the records of Bhagat Singh available with the department and other areas. Then we are also coming up one new building for the preservation and maintenance of the records of Transport Department, MCD, Death and Birth, and Land Records, etc. In the end, I convey my sincere thanks to the Government of NCT of Delhi for full support of development of the archives. With these words, I conclude my PPT. Thank you.
Thank you, Sanjayji, letting us know about what all is being done under Delhi State Archives. It's a very impressive collection, and I'm sure once it is put to the public access, many researchers, individuals will greatly benefit. Actually, that is the beauty of these archives. These archives possesses our heritage for posterity. And unfortunately, most of our archives are not having that public access in terms of anywhere, anytime. They still depend or need to come visit the archives. And so I think these your project will definitely be a boost and maybe a very bright step in the positive direction. And I'm sure we all look forward to the success of this project. And I'm sure it will be beneficial not to just Indian researcher, but researcher all over the world.
Yeah.
Because I'm member of a committee of South Asian libraries in USA. They always look for many Indian literature, particularly research on South Asian studies and also on Indology and other areas. So I think this is a very, and I'm happy to know about it. Thank you very much. So now we have use up to experts from the field of microfilming, reprography, and their views on the collections and the technology. Now, we want to know from the person from industry, Mr. Hari, what new development has taken place in this technology and what all it is an offering and how it is different as in case of microfilming earlier. What are the new challenges? What are the new opportunities available in this field of microfilming? So, Hari, let's over to you. And I will tell you, Hari, we have 735 people have joined this webinar. That's a very, very large number. And it is amazing to see the interest of the people. It means people are interested in knowing about these technologies. So, you can now start your presentation.
Yeah, good afternoon, everybody. I would straight away go into the presentation. The scope of the presentation, we are going to talk about the experience that we have. We are going to talk about digitization with the best of the technologies. We are also going to talk about the shortfall in digital storage, as well as the technology for microfilming. Our experience, we were the first ones to introduce services in overhead scanning. We were the first ones to introduce microfilming, COM microfilming. Also, we are the first ones to introduce microfilm scanning services in India. The current problems that everybody faces in the hard copy storage, the physical storage, is one is the space is a major problem with infrastructure, safety, and dependency on people. Damages caused due to various pests, natural disasters like earthquake, floods, and fire, which has destroyed huge volumes of records across the industry, not just in the archival or the libraries, but also any industry which is holding public records. Then you have aging problem with the documents, and then it's always time consuming. You can see the floods, how it has destroyed huge volumes of records, and this has happened across the country in every department. The Delhi Natural History Museum, if everybody is aware of this, there's a huge fire and the entire records were destroyed. Hard copy record losses in India, registration departments across the country, which holds the most valuable records, the property records, then Indian Railways, Natural History Museum, Hyderabad High Court, Mantralaya, the list goes on and on. The solution, the best solution is going to be digitize and then have a permanent preservation. For digitization, the most important is the technology what you're going to use while scanning. Then storage in multiple medias, digital medias I'm talking about, document management system to have the best document management system, and then to have a DR center for disaster recovery. Different papers, I'm not getting into it. There are various papers. Apart from these, you also have files, public records, and engineering drawings, apart from the normal documents. And you have also special materials like estampages, coins, copper plates, slides, photographs, negatives. You know, there are huge number of records which can be always preserved, digitized and preserved. We're talking about technology. We're talking about overhead scanning technology for scanning. We're talking about wide format scanners. So choosing the right scanners is very important to get the right quality of the output. Here we have specialized scanners for photos, palm leaves, negative, positive, slides, coins, and others. And microfilm, once you have the microfilm in place, you can also scan back. And these are the microfilm scanners for scanning back to digital. The process while doing the scanning is you need to ensure that editing is done, deskew, removal of dots, crop, removal of corners. These are the basic things. And then you have the post-processing where your document is arranged in the right way, which is presentable and accessible in future. Instant access, instant, now digital storage, what is the advantage? The only advantage you have is it's meant for instant access, easy storage, and web transfer, easy for transferring across your web. Is digital storage reliable? You always feel it is safe. Anybody you ask, he says, I'm safe, I have a DR center, I have a, you know, a additional storage with me. But there's a major shortfall in digital storage. You have a problem with migration, invisible data, it's always made of charges, it's most feeble, obsolescence of technology, you don't know when it's going to happen. And then every media of digital is a magnetic tape. It's a magnetic media. And then guarantee is never provided for the data stored, it is only for the media. So you've lost records, it's lost forever. Reasons for digital losses, there are various reasons. Hacking, virus, human error, you know, power fluctuations. The major drawbacks, it's always dynamic. Digital is always dynamic. You don't know when it's going to change. Hacking, virus, migration, human error. A small delete button can destroy huge volumes of records. Affected by power, electromagnetic, static fields, fraud, and short life. Few notable global disasters. We're talking about Amazon, and I've selected very few most important organizations which have lost huge records. Amazon web server failure. We talk about Google loses cloud data storage. CRN is one of the best organizations for providing antivirus softwares, anti-hacking softwares, and they themselves are withdrawing from cloud backup because they were not able to safeguard public records. Biometric fingerprints lost, federal employees was lost in the US, 1.9 billion records stolen and deleted worldwide. UK health system lost its medical records. From 2013, 9 billion records have been lost across the globe. Google says we are throwing all our records to information black hole, means it will never return back. This is told by the vice president Google. Sensitive documents, data lost in across the globe, 92 million, 50 million, these, it's all running into millions. Entire city in the US was, it was hacked, and the entire city had to sleep for 3 weeks. Nothing worked in the city. This is a gist of whatever has been told about the data losses. NASA, the American records, the government records, you know, it's endless. And even in India, there's huge losses of records, including banks. These are the few things which we need to ask oneself. Is your records safe, secure, dynamic? Is it going to be hacked, human dependency, electromagnetic field? These are various things which we have put across. Even if you have one of these problems in your record storage, that means you are not safe. Now comes technology best for long-term preservation. There's always a confusion with which technology, which media, and which software to be used. Here we are talking about digital for instant, microfilm for eternal, permanent preservation. Microfilm enables tangible storage, 100% safe, 98% less space, water resistant, technology independent, long-term, 500 year storage, free from electromagnetic field, EMP, 100% safe from hackers, virus, fraudsters. There's a government mandate central government mandate, which clearly says category A means keep and microfilm. So any record that needs to be preserved for more than 10 years, it has to be microfilmed as per the government norms, which no department does. There are very few organizations who have or are getting into this. The myth of microfilm technology, always it's considered it's an old technology, it's obsolete technology, you need skilled labors, technology oriented. You know, it's a very slow process. But with the COM technology, you have, it's a direct digital to microfilm, high speed, fully automated solution. The paradigm shift from analog to digital, earlier it used to be on the analog microfilm machines from 1839, the oldest technology and till today used across the globe. And we have the latest robotic machine, the SMA microfiche converter is a robotic machine which will directly print as you give it, it works like a normal printer. The life expectancy of various medias, I think the other, it is already provided by others also in this presentation. Advantage of microfilm, as I've already told you, it's waterproof, tested and recommended by scientific community, 98% less space, tangible. It's safe from hackers, virus, migration, any kind of, it's also accepted by code of law. Recommended by international standards, ISO, American national standards, British standards, Australian, New Zealand, everybody recommends it. Washington state standards recommended. It's also Data Archival Association. It's a set of blue chip companies who say that there is no replacement to microfilm. Microfilm recommended in India. Administrative reforms and public grievances, manual of office procedures, Ghosh committee recommendation, National Archives of India, RBI. RBI has their own archives, including Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi has asked to do the microfilm. Recommended by Defense Minister, Coal Ministry, Tamil Nadu and Karnataka already, it has been recommended by the IT and e-governance department. Microfilm standards, we are talking about two different standards. One is the microfilm rolls, you have 35 mm and 16 mm. And on the microfiche, the other part is the microfiche. Both these are microfilm formats and they all have the same life expectancy of 500 years. Storage advantage. Now, when you come comparing to the hard copy storage and the microfilm storage, the entire shelves, what you see there is put into a single cabinet. So you can store about 1 crore records into a cabinet. This is the bird's eye view of storage media, 10,000 square feet area for 1 crore record. And you just need one cabinet or an almara for storing the entire records. Microfilm image retrieval, it's a tangible storage, so it's independent of technology and you just need a magnifying glass and a light source to view it. Apart from that, you have various companies who are manufacturing scanners, microfilm scanners, where you can scan back your, if you have lost any digital records, scan back your microfilm and replace your lost digital records. Always remember, use the microfilm which is independent of technology, and you can use any normal microfilm scanners to scan them back. This is the entire process of digitization and microfilming, where the document is taken, you do the scanning, you do a quality check, and then you send it, you can do a PDF conversion and store it for digital preservation, and then you do a microfilming, do a microfilm quality check, that is the MBT test, and then backup preparation and then store your microfilm. So any department who wants to do this can achieve it by moving their legacy records by using the scanners to scan, put it in the digital database and then microfilm and have a microfilm data storage. Microfilm uses in India, National Archives, Delhi State Archives, Tamil Nadu State Archives, Rajbhavan, IGNCA, Government Oriented Research Laboratory, there are various, there are many people who are now very keen on preserving their records. There are more than 80 countries using COM microfilm technology. USA, it's mandatory for any records, including public records, government records, archival records, which needs more than 7 years to be retained on the microfilm. Russia, Germany, France, UK, all of them follow the same thing. Recently, China, Brazil also has made it mandatory. So what an organization would achieve by doing this entire process? One is a reliable storage solution for invaluable records. Digitization will help easy access of these records. Your document management, having a robust document management system and storage solution will help in easy access and storage. Perennial microfilm storage for important records, which will ensure long life and access for the future generations. Ensure records for 100% safe and secured storage. Ensure records are available for future generation. This is the goal achieved if any organization follows this process of digitization and preservation on microfilm. I thank you all. I would like to thank IGNCA for this opportunity to provide this particular information on storage to all these organizations, because India is lagging behind in both digitization and microfilming. Yes, digitization is moving forward, but then microfilming, it's lagging behind. So I would thank IGNCA for giving this opportunity to bring forward both digitization and microfilming in the right sense. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Hari, for letting us know about latest technological developments and also how we should look for this technology. And also you have given good examples where people are exploring or people have been using. I think some of the slide I'm feeling happy that some of the people are really understanding. But I fully agree with you that we need to have proper awareness about the exact nature of this technology and how it is useful. And also what are the areas where it can be implemented. Definitely now IGNCA is having, stop share your screen. IGNCA is having number of academic programs. As a dean, I am responsible for 8 PG diploma courses and 5 certificate courses. And we are also trying to become a Deemed to University. And in this regard, there are a number of things we are planning to have innovative courses. And one of the courses we explore is on this infographic science and technology. We definitely would like to take your suggestion on improving the course contents, and before launch, we may discuss it further. So I think we'll take up questions later. And now, let's have views and presentation of one of the very active library and a very dynamic librarian, Dr. Ajit Kumar. So Ajit, would like to know you from how Nehru Memorial Museum Library is using these microfilm collection. What are the how it is being stored? What are the services and facilities provided by Nehru Memorial Museum? So over to Ajit for your presentation. Ajit, can you unmute yourself? Ajit, your voice is not coming. Please unmute yourself.
Good evening, sir. I am Priya Sharma from NEJD.
Priya, Ajit, Ajit, can you hear us, Ajit? Your voice is not coming. Ajit, we can see your screen, but we can't hear you. Priya, can you see Ajit online?
Yes, sir, I can see him. I request Ajit, sir, to kindly connect with the computer audio so that he would be able to speak and we would be able to hear.
Ajit, can you hear me?
Sir, he is not connected with the computer audio.
He is not connected, no? Not able to listen us also.
I'm just making call to him. Just wait for a moment. Dr. Ajit, just connect your computer with computer audio, please. Your audio is not audio. Yeah. You just click. No, that is. Click that option.
Ajit, can you hear me? So, meantime, till Ajit got connected, I will try to take up certain questions. There is somebody asking about how many digital archives available in India. How can one access information? Is there any membership plan? So, there are a number of things. In terms of digital libraries, there is a National Digital Library of India. Asiatic Society Mumbai has also created a digital archive of some manuscript and rare books. Now Delhi State Archive is also converting. At IGNCA, we have near about 3 lakhs manuscript in digital format. We also have more than 1 lakh slides, near about same number of photographs and other visuals. We have more than 5,000 rare books in digital. So all these things are available to access with us. So I think this was the question somebody had asked. And there are a number of repositories available. If you see the research Google, you will be able to find out number of more repositories, both in terms of cultural institutions and other institutions. So this is the one question. There is a question, which is first digital archives of India, which archives done first time digitized in India, which archives done highest number of pages digitization in uploaded on its website public, which agency verifies the digitization work done by digitization as apt and following rules. I think it looks like a questioner for research programs. He is asking many questions, but I will tell you many of these information are historical in nature. Agency started digitization almost in the 99 or 2000. I have explained you what we have digitized. Under National Mission for Manuscript, a number of manuscripts have been digitized. So there are a number of things digitization has taken place. Ajit, can you hear us or not? Dibas, what he saying when you called him? Dibas?
I'm just calling him again.
Yeah, Ajit, can you hear me? Ajit?
No, he has connected on mobile.
Ajit, can you start presentation?
Yes, he can.
Ajit, please start talking.
Now, you are hearing me, sir?
Yes, now we can hear you.
Okay. Sir. So, before giving the information, having a different collections on the modern Indian history, and it was established in 1966 as a research library in social science. And it was basically designed and developed as a specific research institute, reference center on the colonial and post-colonial India, with its very rich and varied collection of books, microfilms, microfiches, newspaper and periodicals, and photographs. And the all resources of the institution, we can categorize in the two categories, documentary resources and non-documentary resources. As far as the documentary resources are concerned, the library has approximately 3 lakhs books and bound only periodicals and approximately 2 lakhs photographs. Some of the rare documents you can see, Life, Adventure, Robinson, etc., European history, etc. And India National Congress Library. Photo section with the library possesses more impressive collection of the photographs of the Indian Freedom Movement and National Leaders of India. Some of the important collection we have in library, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, K.R. Narayan collection, Haksa collection, and etc. As far the documentary resources are concerned, the library has more than 19,000 microfilm and 52,000 microfiche plates, which is a very important and rare collection of the in our library. Some of the rare, you can see the Bengal Gazettes and the Calcutta Journal. And we have the online resources also, like Jester, Ease Journals, and Open Access Journals, etc. in our library. Now I'm talking about the services in our library. Different kind of services are providing to the readers of the institution, like SDI, newspaper clippings, book review index, newspaper alerts, and reprography services. So today is the demand of the webinar is a reprography services, and I'm going to discuss about that. See, these are the upper microfilm section of the library. So who can, question it is, who can use the library services of the microfilm of the library? The person has to be a member of the library. Once a person get the membership of the library, they are entitled to use the library facilities, particularly related to microfilm. In the microfilm, we have the microfilm reader and microfiche reader. You can see the people stop in our library. He is just trying to pull the microfilm reader, trying to readily available for the readers. These are the microfilm and microfiche available in the library. These are the roles which are available in the library. No, what's the process for using the reprography services in the library? After getting the membership of the library, the researcher normally at first identify the required information, what actually they want. And after identification, they have to book, because you know we have so many members in the library. They want to use the library facilities, particularly the microfilm, macrophage at the same time. So we have the booking facility. Once have they have to book at first for accessing that information, either from the microfilm or for the macrophage. For that purpose, they are booking that information in the prior basis. Then they have to access that information through the readers. Then selection of the, they have to select, while searching, they have to select the information, what actually they require while moving the, going through the screen. Once they have selected the required information, they have to give their request to the concerned officer sitting in the microfilm section in the writing. Then we had processed that information, request information to the reprography section. We have the different reprography section. We have the two parts in our institution. One is the reprography section where we have putting the all objectives of the microfilm, and second copy we are putting in the library for the services. Once the information has identified which information they want, accordingly to their request, we are giving that request to the reprography section. Once they have, and for that purpose, we are charging. They have to pay some charges of that particular required information. And after giving the payment, the required information may be provided to the reference, to the readers. See, these are the things which we are doing in our services, library services. But it is in our practice in library, whatever work we are doing the survey for particularly for the reader satisfaction. Recently, before the lockdown, we had gone through a survey, and during the survey, we had distributed the questionnaire among the 60 researchers, and 51 has responded. And there, the according to research, it shows that researchers out of 51, 16% researcher scholars, they are using the institutional resources, and the 63% maximum person using the newspaper collection. So our library is the very good in the newspaper collection, and 21% they are using the private collections. So we can see the our institutional paper like Hunter Commission report, newspaper, Bombay Chronicle, these are very rare, which are not available in the any most of the library. And it has been also noticed while survey, people are coming across the world in our library, but 78% from the India and other person from the different countries. See, then we thought we should know in which area they are doing their research work. It has been identified, as you know, our library is basically the best of the modern Indian history library. So 55% researcher use that information, and after that 17% on the Indian history, and the rest one is the from the other resources and the literature and Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru resources. So we also see the frequency of the people, then we can identify 52.94% people are coming every day. So you can see the utilities of the library. People are thinking, oh, this library has a good resources, you must visit the library. So, and you can see from the India, 47.6% people visit, and from the USA 7.1%, and from England 11.77%, and from other countries 33.33%. So these are the things we had given about the resources, and we can see. Then lastly, we want to know how much they are satisfied with the resources and the services of the Nehru Memorial Museum and Library. Then you can see that 27.45% people say this is a very good collection in the term of services and the collection also. And 49.02% says the average. And all are mostly people are saying they're very good, and 5% says the average. So these are things. Now we also trying to know for what purpose they are coming to the library and consulting the our microfilm resources. Then we can confirm that 23% people are coming for preparing their lecture notes and rest one they are doing for the research guide and the formulation of the project and writing publication and journal and proceedings, or others for the exhibition also. Lastly, then we had observed, according to our observation, we found that we are very proud. We have the such collection in our library, particularly in the microfilm, microfiche section. Still, we are providing the services since more than two or three or four decades. And existing, we are providing the services. And we received the information, we received the request from the researcher. They want in the latest digital format so they can access 24/7. I want to tell you, my dear colleagues and researchers and attendees, we are in the process for the digitization, and as a pilot project, we had done the microfilming of Sardar Patel and digitization and photograph collection. About 50,000 photographs has been already digitized, and we are putting at the website of the Nehru Memorial Museum Library. Any researcher can access through payment gateway. So these are the resources. Lastly, we can tell you, we are proud of our collections, and really I am thankful to Dr. Gaur, who has given the chance to share my services to the different scholars across the India and the world. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Any questions, sir?
Thank you, Ajit. Definitely we'll take up the questions now. Please stop sharing your screen, and now we'll come back to the question answer session. So let me see first in QA, what are the questions lined up for everybody. So in this, let me just first tell every participants about the certificates and other thing. They have been sending a lot of queries in chat and everything. See, all of you will be given a certificate. We will use the data you have used for registration. So in case if you have not put your surname and first name correctly in registration, then you have logged into the system, you need to send your detail correctly. But if you have correctly mentioned your name and surname in the registration box, we will use the same data and we will send you the e-certificates. We will also upload the PPTs on the Google Drives. So you can just have a look through the PPTs on Google Drive. All the certificates will be uploaded on Google Drive and link will be sent to you. Similarly, all the PPT will be uploaded on Google Drive and link will be sent to you. So this was the questions regarding your certificates. Now, there is a question from Naro Maron Singh. Is there facilities for government institutes to provide digitization of archives owned by private museum? Because we don't have such infrastructure in our institute. Thank you. Mr. Sanjay Gai, would you like to answer this question? This is a question from Arun Singh. Is there any facility available from government institute to provide help in digitization of archives of own private museums?
Sorry, we are not imparting any services to any institution. We are only doing our own archiving.
Okay. So, I will respond to him. See, National Archive of India provides a certain grant for digitization of material and also in archiving. So, there is a scheme of National Archive of India. Mr. Arun Singh, you can apply for that scheme. And there are a number of other support available from various ministries. You can also collaborate with certain institutions. They can help you in digitization. And if you need more details, you can call me. We'll discuss it further. There is another question related to this, how many digital archives I've already responded. So let me see in chat box if anybody has put any questions in chat box. We'll take up questions from the chat box. In meantime, I want to ask Hari.
Yes, sir.
Hari, can you tell me, like, Although you have given a very detailed presentation, but I want to know in a brief manner. Now, the process from digital to microfilm, how reliable it is? And second thing, what about your take on color microfilming?
With regards to your second question regarding color microfilming, I think not many takers and not many manufacturers are there in this field. There was only one country who was using color microfilming, that was in Switzerland. But no other country, even in the US, they do only the grayscale or the black and white filming.
We are still in black and white kind of
thing. Yeah, but black and white, grayscale, basically it's grayscale.
Grayscale, yeah.
And second thing is coming to reliability of COM microfilming, it's as good as the analog microfilming. The whole world has moved to digital, the COM microfilming, because analog is a very slow process. You need technical experts to handle these machines. But when it comes to COM, it's like a normal printer. You have your scanned images and you just say print, and then your films are ready. You know, in the COM technology, it's as simple as that. And it is totally, it's automated. Its entire system is automated. So you don't have any human interference while doing a microfilm. In the microfilm, you have two processes. You do the microfilm conversion, and then you send it for processing into the bath. But in the microfish, it's totally automated. You just say print, and the fish gets exposed, processed, and it is ready for preservation. It's 100% safe, better than the analog process, I can say.
Right. Priya, can I request you to start that feedback poll for the participants? My next question is to Mr. Sanjay Gar. The project, which it's a very important project. So when do you expect that? Like, first thing is, are you going to put all the contents under open access? Second is that when we are going to see this archive online?
Sir, already that 1.70 crore pages is already online. And we have approximately 1400 concurrent user who is using that archives.
Is it open access?
Yeah,
great. It's
open access.
Great. So can you type
after registration, you can access that records.
Yeah. So can you type that link in the chat box? Because many people will be very happy to know, and maybe like many of them are librarians working in different institutes, they will further circulate and people will be able to know about.
Yeah, definitely, sir.
Yeah. And which particular software you are using for digital archiving?
Actually, we have purchased the software of NewsGen.
Okay.
For that, and we have customized that software as per the requirement of the archives.
Right.
Yeah.
So they are managing it, or how you are uploading, or the company is doing that all upload?
Yeah, actually, company is uploading, but we have the supervision.
Okay. Good. Deepraj, are you online?
Yes, sir. Yes, yes.
Yeah. So, we were planning to start this new course on demographic science and technology. You proposed me that, and we are working on that. I just understand, how it is different from the course which National Archive is having in place. How the course which we are proposing, how it is different from the one National Archive is providing?
Actually, I have seen the syllabus of National Archives. So most of the things which are being taught over there, that is on the traditional one. The latest one, latest technology, that like the digital technology, digital preservation point of view, has not been incorporated in that. So we are here talking about COM system, means hybrid system. So we have to preserve the material in both the ways, microfilm as well as digital form. So we have to integrate all together, and we have to give a new term like digital reprography, course in digital reprography type. So that way it will be little difficult, different from that.
we will just learn not only the preservation but the access too. So both the things has to be got together.
Right. Anyone of you can respond. What about microfilming of big size oil paintings and copper plates? Like suppose somebody want to do imaging, and if it is possible, then what kind of machine is required? Like suppose somebody want to, I think this is more of a digitization rather than microfilming.
Yeah.
This question is more related to digitization. So, I think there are various kind of cameras. Would like Sanjay would like to respond to it?
Hello.
Would like to
Sir, actually, we are using the I2S big size scanner for converting the A0 size maps.
Mm-hmm. A0 size map.
Yeah.
There is one.
But we have actually the thing is that we have more than big size of A0 size. So we are stitching all these maps also.
So thank you. And there is one question somebody is asking. Most of them are giving feedback, very informative, very knowledgeable. I just want to understand from Ajit, you have a lot of news clipping in microfilm and microfiche format, old news clippings. What are the other collections, important collection, which you have in your microfilm collection?
Hello.
Ajit.
Hello.
Ajit.
My sound is coming?
Yeah, coming.
My sound is coming, sir.
Yes, you can speak.
Sir, we have the Census of India. Census of India since the first volume. And we have the personal collection, very huge personal collection of different personalities. So which are not available in the anywhere library. And Library of Congress, we have Sipujan Sahai collection, we have rare collection, we have Sipujan Sahai, which are not available in any library in India, except Library of Congress UK. It's a very rare collection, sir. It's a very rare collection.
Okay, good. So I think I don't see many other questions. I think I will like to have a last round of questions from each panelist. I want to begin with Mr. Sanjay Garg. How do you see the future of this microfilming? If people are not properly aware of it, its advantages, like you are doing digitization of your entire, do you have plan to convert this in microfilm also?
Actually, sir, the thing is that microfilming is the ultimate. And for posterity, actually paper life is, they have certain life. And after that, that will deteriorate or will collapse. So that's why we have to convert each and every object into the microfilm as well as the digital.
So do you have any plan after digitization to convert into microfilm?
We are simultaneously converting all the digital image into the microfilm.
Okay, great. That's a very good example. So like people may learn from you like how to do both digitization and microfilming too.
Yeah.
Hari.
Yes.
You remember our member secretary talks about Atmanirbhar Bharat means how we can think of. Do you see any possibility or feasibility in producing nowadays? I don't the Kodak. You if you have to acquire microfilm rolls, you have to order in well in advance and the manufacturing on demand.
Yes.
After this pandemic situation, many companies are leaving China or they are discontinuing operations. So how do you see the future of if we have any prospects of industry? And now apart from that, second question is that because of lack of demand, even the agencies are also very limited and they are not very confident because they are not getting very good business, and that's why they are switching over to other areas. So with all these complexity, as an industry person, how you see this?
Definitely, like we have been interacting with Germany also to have some kind of a facility in India. But the problem is with the demand and, you know, bringing in knowledge to all the departments and, you know, places where the records are kept in depositories. It's huge. The volumes are huge, and also the data lost is huge. So people have to, you know, gear up. I see like even registration departments where, you know, they have only digital storage without a backup. You know, in it all runs in crores of records. In Karnataka, they have about 16 crore records only in digital. These are land registration records. And anytime, it's like a bomb, you know, anytime it can burst. So one has to realize that the best storage is microfilm, and once this industry grow, you can definitely find people who are interested to start manufacturing in India, put facilities in India. That will happen, but then there should be a demand for it. And our basic work is to create demand. We have been trying to promote this, you know, from ages. You know it well. So now, yes, there are a lot of organizations who are coming forward. They're realizing it, but it has to move on. It has to move forward.
There's been a positive movement in that.
Yes, definitely.
Deepas, there is a question to you also. Somebody is saying nice presentation. And saying that there is a lot of manuscript in Kashmir. So do you have any... many manuscripts in private collection. Do you have any geographical access to this region in order to save this heritage? Do we have any collection from manuscript in Kashmir, manuscript from Kashmir?
No, we don't have much collection. We have got only some manuscript on Charar-e-Sharif. So I think only 4 manuscripts are there from that particular. So most of the data from that particular location is not there. We don't have.
I add to you. We have manuscript collection from Dr. Karan Singh's museum library. SRS? So we have manuscript from them, and also I think under National Mission for Manuscript, we have also digitized manuscript from Kashmir, Srinagar, that state museum, state library or state museum, what is that in? So we have some collections from Kashmir. So Ajit, do you have any plan to convert some of your existing material which is not in microfilm, which is in print or in digital only, to microfilm?
Sir, we are planning to do the all material which were available in the hard copy to the microfilming and digital also. Both.
Good. They are asking some questions. What are the copyright issues involved in reprography and digitization, especially with free sharing?
Sir, actually, what I am telling you, because people are using that reprography material for their research work. So for their research work, there is no copyright issue. They can use it, and we have the certain copyright, that copyright permission we are giving to the researchers.
Okay.
Suppose some materials we don't have the copyright, we are giving the only information, and the responsibility of the readers and users, they have to take the permission from the concerned authority.
Thank you, Ajit. So, friends, we are almost reached the end of the program. And it was wonderful to have you all. Thank you, Sanjay ji, for your wonderful knowledge. I'm sure people will be benefiting. These recordings will be available on YouTube. So, we already have 700 people here, and then many will view on the YouTube all these recordings of presentations and also your views. Thank you, Hari. It is nice to meet with you after a long time. And I'm happy to see that you have the same intro of working in this field. You have given up despite of so many ups and downs. That's a good thing. And thank you, Ajit. You are doing good work. Keep doing. You are working in a very historical library. And surely, my colleague Dukas is my big assets in IGMC, and he's always keen. And this entire webinar is on idea. He created this webinar, and whatever we have discussed today, it was his brainchild. So thank you, Dukas, for all wonderful work you are doing. I would also like to thank our member secretary, Dr. Sachidanand Joshi, who is very, very supportive of all such webinars. And he is always very, very, very supportive of all academic and research programs. In the end, I would like to say that digital is very important. I am the member of two important international committee, International Committee of Advisory Committee of UNESCO Memory of the World Program. Recently, just this month, I have been nominated to Cultural Heritage Program Advisory Committee of IFLA, International Federation of Library Association. And I have served with the various Digital Gunung China and ICDS and many international organizations. One thing is very sure that every media has a certain life. No media can be sustained for a longer duration without having a alternative like microfilm, because all these digital technologies are good for access, but their life expectancy is very, very low and uncertain. So if we totally depend upon digital technology, we are always in uncertainties. So the most important thing for all the people is to understand, let's identify the material which need to be preserved for the posterity. And that material need to be converted both in digital and microfilm. And not just conversion, also a proper storage, proper handling. And also, we need to have good training in this emerging technologies. We need to have good manpower. And I'm sure today's discussion will create some awareness, because many people even don't understand various nitty-gritty of these microfilming and microfish. IGNCA, the largest organization of this country in terms of microfilm and microfish after National Archive of India, maybe RBI may be having more than us. But in terms of cultural heritage, we are the largest organization, and we understand this importance. And continuously, we are trying to promote this technology. And I always say that have both the option in place, and affordability is a quite really issue, but I think government also will understand that for such material we need to have good both technologies in place. With these words, I personally thanks all the panelists and our member secretary, and now hand over this to my colleague, our research officer, Dr. Jasveer Singh, who would like to propose a formal vote of thanks.
Thank you, sir. Good evening to all. It is my immense pleasure to propose vote of thanks on this wonderful occasion. I acknowledge my sincere thanks for the opportunity to IGNCA. I would like to thank to Honorable Dr. Sachidanand Joshi ji, Member Secretary IGNCA, for providing opportunity to organize such event. We are delighted with his remarks on the occasion. We hope that we will continue to get his support. It is insufficient to express my acknowledgement and thank to Professor R.C. Gaud, Dean and Head Kalanidhi, for organizing the event on such a most relevant topic for the world. I would also like to thank our expert Shiv Sanjay Garg, Head of the Office, Delhi State Archive, Delhi, for delivering lecture on challenges in digitization and microfilming records in Delhi Archive. I also express my heartfelt thanks to We am Hari, Technical Director, Craft India, Bangalore, for sharing his experience on the theme of the webinar. I would also like to thank our expert, Dr. Ajit, Library and Information Officer, Nehru Memorial Museum and Library, for delivering lecture on reprography service at Nehru Memorial Museum and Library. I would like to also thank to Dr. Deep Raj Gupta, Senior Reprography Officer, IGNCA, for very informative lecture on reprography, science and technology. I will not justify my duties if I would not express my sincere thanks to participant, delegates, research scholars, and a student who attend the webinar across the globe. I would like to thank organizing team, staff of Kalanidhi, various departments of IGNCA, who works continue to make the webinar a grand success. I would also like to thank Priya Sharma from NGD for providing Zoom platform for the virtual webinar. Last but not least, thank you one and all. Thank you. Thank you very much.